go ahead and open up to John 15. Everything in me as a teacher wants to review, starting back at John 14, verse 1. But the trouble is, when you do that, you don't get very far. And this is the shortest service of the day. I just love watching the mind of Christ weave together the messages, because watching, or listening rather, to Nathan in the first hour this morning, and then how Alan came, and the Holy Spirit just picked up and expanded on the same message, because I know that we don't collaborate. We don't get together, well, what are you teaching on? What are you teaching on? We don't do any of that at all. We just spend time with the Holy Ghost and the Word and pray. And so the flow really comes over into tonight also. And let me review, because some of you couldn't be here at 8:30. Nathan, how many of you know Nathan has a message or two about the conscience? And the voice, that inner voice that begins to speak. I usually go back to my earliest days, the first few weeks after I was born again, and suddenly there was a new sheriff in town. There was a new preacher on the inside. I wasn't hearing it on the outside. There was a new preacher on the inside. And I got saved, and he was right away, he started telling me things like, we're going to have to deal with this alcohol. We're going to have to deal with the pornography in the house. We're going to have to deal with forgiveness and a lot of things. And it was all I remember so well, because my mind would argue with it. That's what he was saying this morning. Just because you get born again does not mean every stronghold immediately comes down, see. Thank God for Pastor Dave, who has taught us all these years about how to deal with strongholds. But how many of you know that new preacher in town is Christ? That is Christ in you. It is it's not literally a little Jesus, but it is everything he is in you. And so we've been starting, we're not going to do it tonight, but in Colossians 1:27, which is the mystery that's been hidden from the foundations of the world, that mystery now being preached even to the Gentiles is Christ in you, your hope of glory. Amen. Well, Alan comes along and expands on that very thing, you know. And one of the things that Nathan brought out again and again, he said there's this doctrine going around the world. Some people call it identity. I haven't exactly heard that one yet. And there's a lot of truth in that. How many of you knows we need to know who we are in Christ? We need to know who that new man is. We need to know what he has done for us. Otherwise, you're going to be led around by doctrine, false doctrine, that says you're still an old sinner, just saved by grace. And no bigger lie was ever told. Nowhere does the Bible say that. No, you were an old sinner. Got that right. You were an old sinner. You got saved by grace. Now you're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, and you're his child. And so I love how the Holy Spirit is weaving that all together. But I've learned, it's not exactly the identity doctrine going around, but what we term normally as hyper-grace message, where you can take anything and run off in the ditch with it. Did I say go to John 15? Good. Because they say, and I can give you in their books, that's why I like to get them on Kindle, where I can search and I can copy and I can paste and I can directly quote what they say in volume and page from what they say. All of them that I've read after, so in one form or another, say this: you have to be very careful when it comes to the teachings of Jesus, because he was sent to the Jews before the cross. So we live on this side of the cross. Paul is the apostle to the Gentiles. I know, it's laughable. So Paul is the apostle of grace. You need to listen to what he says, but you have to be very careful, because many of the teachings of Jesus, now this is what they say, not what Gary says, many of the teachings of Jesus do not apply to the church today. Is that heresy to the 10th power or what? Now, they'll even go so far as to get very specific. They'll take like Mark 11, 22, 23, 24, 25, where he says, and if you don't forgive from your heart every person their trespasses against you, neither will your heavenly Father forgive you your trespasses. Literally, I can show you in their books, they say, you don't have to obey that. That doesn't apply to a New Testament Christian. You're so forgiven. He's already paid for every sin. You are so forgiven, you don't need to forgive anymore. Now here's the scary part. Christians believe that. And why would they believe it? John chapter 15. So let me show you what I mean by that. John chapter 15. Now, plus, this has everything. I'm not really teaching on hyper grace tonight. That's just one example. But I am teaching as the necessity of His Word abiding in you. And I'm not just talking about your blueprint. I am including that, what He has said to you specifically. But tonight, I'm really focusing on the red letters, the words of Jesus to us. So here He's teaching to His disciples. Now remember, we're only hours before the cross. We're right near the end of His ministry. These men have been following Him for 3.5 years. He is letting them know that He's about to leave the planet and go be with the Father. And He's introducing the ministry of the Holy Spirit, the Comforter who is to come, the one that's going to lead and guide them. But notice what He says here. And again, this is all, if you haven't heard the previous messages leading up to this, you need to listen. Because He tells them, basically, I have brought you as far as I can. Why? He doesn't tell them this, but it's because they're natural men. They're not born again yet. They don't have a spirit which can be taught of God. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 says, Now, we have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit which is of God. Well, that's the new birth. That we might know the things that have been given to us freely by God. That's our inheritance. These things are, for later on, he says, the natural man cannot know these things. He can't understand them because they are spiritually discerned. See, well, you got to have a nature, a spirit on the inside of you, born of God, in order to be taught by Him. Well, you reckon Jesus understood all that? They don't understand it, but He understands it, okay? So He's preparing them for what's to come. So look, John 15, 1. He says, I am the true vine. My Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, He taketh away. Every branch that beareth fruit, He purges it that it may bring forth more fruit. Now you are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. We could teach a long time right there. They are so changed. You remember when Peter rebuked Jesus to His face? Jesus says, I'm going to be arrested. The Son of Man is going to be crucified. I'm going to die. And Peter, to His face, says, this shall not be unto you. How strong is that? Peter is purged now. Peter has been purged from that. It's no longer what I think. It's whatever you think. You know, he may not be totally purged yet, but before this is over, he's going to deny the Lord within 24 hours here 3 times. Trust me, he's about to be purged. I was wrong, Jesus, you're right. I got one beyond that. I'm always wrong, you're always right. But through this process, and they thought when the Messiah come, he would throw off this Roman conquering giant and raise up Israel and a political kingdom. They thought an earthly kingdom was to come right then. Well, they've been purged of that. Before this is over, they've been purged. They thought Old Testament, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth and love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy. But he's introduced to them, no, you need to love your enemies. Pray for them. So there's been a lot of purging. When he says, you are clean, purged through the word that I've spoken unto you, there's been a lot of purging already, and they're not even born again yet. But it's because never man spake like this man. He spoke in a way that nobody'd ever heard before. But we haven't really got to it yet. Now we're going to get to it here in a minute. Abide in me, and I in you. I can't pass it up, I'm sorry. If you write in the margin, you don't have to do this. You could put right there the book of Hebrews. The whole book of Hebrews is about that sentence. Hebrews is written to Jewish people who did become Christian. They were raised under the law. How do I please God, Daddy? You keep the law, son. And if you stumble, you offer the appropriate sacrifice. Okay, that's how they grew up. But then somebody comes and preaches Christ who is the end of, you know, righteousness, trusting in Christ is the end of the law to all who believe, right? No, you put your trust in the Lamb. He is the final single offering. You put your trust in His finished work, not in your ability to keep the law. So these Jewish people who grew up under one system, they had to change their whole believing system. They become Christian, but then they're suffering terrible persecution. You can read about it in Hebrews. Their goods are being taken from them. Their parents would disown them sometimes. You couldn't even get into the right universities. All kinds of persecution. Well, why? The pressure was give up this, reject this Jesus and go back under the law. Now, he's warning them here. You abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can you, except you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. Say much. Much, much fruit. Much. Amen. Not a little. For without me, you can do nothing. Do you notice the personal pronoun there? The personal pronoun, without me, myself. It's more than that life. It's more than the nature. It's where Christ, the King, the one you're in fellowship with by the Holy Ghost, the one who is alive right now, seated at the right hand of the Father, the one who has, let's say it this way, the one who knows your life to the end, the same way he knew Peter's life to the end, the one that has a plan for your life, the same way he had a plan for Peter's life. He says, I will be in you. For without me, you can do nothing. I am the vine. He is the life. We are the branch. Let me say it another way. Where is he physically seated? At the right hand of the Father, in that realm of the Spirit, okay, in heaven. But he's the life. He's there, but we are here. But there is a connection by this Spirit, this one that you got born again. Dave meticulously taught us in Romans chapter 8 how it is that same Spirit, not the Holy Spirit, the same life that quickened Jesus from death to life is exactly that same life that quickened you from death to life. And there, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature, and you are joined to the Lord by that Spirit. I'd like to call it the portal. That nature is the connection. It is the portal. It is the opening. It is the door between the realm of the Spirit and the realm of the natural. And for all practical purposes, when we allow him, when you lay your hand on the sick, it's no less than him, even though he's seated there, laying his hand on the sick. No wonder all things are possible. No wonder we'll do the same works. Amen? Now notice, here's Hebrews again. Look at verse 6. If a man abide not in me, well, how would you do that? Hebrews. You reject Jesus. You go back under the law or any other system. What did he start this off with in John 14? I am a way, a truth, and a way unto life. Is that what he said? No, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He's warning them, if a man abide not in me, if you choose some other path besides this one, he's cast forth as a branch and withered. And men gather them and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. Could he be any more graphic? Could he paint a more clear picture? There is no other path. I don't care how much the persecution comes. I don't care how bad, how hard it is. Don't forsake Christ. It is Christ or perish. The worst they can do to you is kill you. And that's graduation day. To depart and be with the Lord, which is far better. All right? Now, said all that to get to verse 7. If you abide in me, now notice, and my words abide in you. You shall ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. How important is this? Because he says, herein is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit. How many of you want to glorify the Father on the earth? I do. Well, Jesus glorified the Father. He manifested the Father. He said, if you want to know the Father, look at me. When you see me, you've seen the Father. And what he's saying right here, the Holy Spirit, he says in another place in the same passage, though, the Holy Spirit, he shall glorify me. Well, what does he mean? In them. It should come to the place that when they see us, they see Jesus. I mean, all the time, not just in church. What was that revelation that the Holy Spirit gave Pastor Dave? He said, I want to give you deliverance for the man who stays at home. Remember? Not the one we bring to church, you know, we clean up and real nice, you know. Now, how does Nathan put that? You know, I'm going to give you deliverance for the man who still yells at his wife at home, not the one who cleans up and comes to church, you know. See? I want to bear much fruit all the time, so shall you be my disciples. Now, I want to back up here to verse 7. If you abide in me and my words abide in you. If you look that one up, that's the word rhema. Sometimes in this passage, he uses the word logos, okay? I'm not going to get into the real distinction there, but what is he talking about there? If you abide in me and my words. Well, here's one aspect. Hold your place there. We'll probably come back. Not guaranteeing. And go to the last verse in the book of Matthew. Matthew, come on, Bible. It's getting so dog-eared, I may have to get another one. Matthew 28, now look at verse 19. Go you, therefore, and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. What am I supposed to teach them? Teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Now he's telling them, Alan this morning mentioned a preacher who was preaching, you don't need the Bible. You don't even need this. Because you've got the Holy Ghost. Just pray, and the Holy Ghost will tell you everything you need to know. You don't even need this. I know that preacher. I know who he's talking about. I double-checked. Okay. And he's not the only one. That is not far from what I told you earlier. These hyper-grace teachers, and I mean to a man, every one of them that I've read after say, you just have to be very careful with the words of Jesus because many of his teachings do not apply to the modern day church. And my question to them would be, can you read? What is the instruction? Go and teach all nations. Now, first off, they missed this. Peter missed this. Peter is there. You do know Peter is there the day that this is spoken, right? God has to knock him over, and it's almost 10 years later, by the way, on the rooftop with a vision. Take his senses away from him. This is more than just a little, you know, like a vision driving the truck, you know. This is one where you fall over in a trance. Thank God you don't do that driving a truck down the highway, okay? Ah! And he has to let down that sheet, show him in a vision 3 times. And still Peter doesn't quite understand it, but he got the instruction, go with these Gentiles. And finally Peter got it. That's not the first day that the Lord told him. Do you know there's hope for us? Just because the Lord says something and you didn't get it, he is long-suffering and merciful, and he will send a vision, he'll send a prophet, he'll send however he has to keep sending it over and over and over till you get it. I did a deep study. You know, one of the fruit of the Spirit is long-suffering. And I did a real major study on that word. I wanted to know the Greek of the Greek, the koine of the koine. I studied it out, and I found out long-suffering means to suffer long. And that's the Lord. He told them here. It doesn't get any, you look it up in any lexicon. Look it up. I'm not a scholar, but I can read those Greek lexicons. When it says teach all nations, there is no way to miss what he was saying. He was saying this gospel is not just for the Jews. I expect you to go and teach the Romans and teach the Greeks and teach the Turks and teach the Assyrians. I expect you to go and make disciples. And I want you to teach them the same things that I taught you. Oh, wait a minute. Don't they have the Holy Ghost? Why would you need me to go teach them? If I just get them baptized in the Holy Ghost, isn't that all they need? If it is, why is he instructing them to go and teach them what I taught you? Now listen, the Holy Ghost is a tremendous teacher. But he is not planning on rewriting the New Testament for you personally. He is intent on teaching you the New Testament personally, starting with the words of Jesus. It's his doctrine. He says, I want you to teach them the same things I have taught you. Now get me upset. This is after the resurrection. This event here took place. This is the last things he's saying before he's ascending up into heaven. He's telling them this instruction in our dispensation. Yet you have these people. I heard right there, see, love your enemies. I'm teasing. I made that up. But I have to use restraint. What was it? One preacher said one time, he said, I'd rather watch Gunsmoke than listen to those guys. It's more innocent and less dangerous. Yeah. As a preacher, I really appreciate it. What day, by the way? Anyway, go you therefore and teach all nations. They just couldn't hear it. They couldn't hear it. Peter especially couldn't hear it. 10 years later, he's still thinking, no, it's just for the Jews. I'll tell you another one. That event on the rooftop. And that when, you know, I mean, what the Lord's really talking about is going and preaching the gospel to these Gentiles. But in the vision, he saw all sorts of creeping, crawly, unclean things. And a voice says, arise, Peter, kill and eat. You remember what he said? Not so, Lord. Here you go again. Same thing he said. Not so, Lord. Because he says, nothing unclean has ever gone into my mouth. Now, wait a minute. I could take you back where he was there. That the day that the Lord said, not that which goes into a man defiles the man, but that which comes out of the heart, that's what defiles the man. And on that very day, he declared all foods clean. Peter was there. Yet, not only for the rest of Jesus' earthly life, but for 10 years. Didn't matter what the master said. I ain't eating pork. Now, eventually he did. He finally got purged of that, from that Old Testament doctrine. And he was eating barbecue right along with the other Gentiles. Paul tells about it in Galatians. He says, well, you know, he was eating with the Gentiles. They were just, you know, past the pig's feet, you know. eating their food until he found out that those from James, those from Jerusalem were coming. Oh, well, now. And Paul had to correct him, see. All right. What I'm getting at tonight. Get a minute. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you. Now, I'm all about the blueprint. I am all about you finding out his particular individual path for your life. I am all about that. You know I'm all about that. But I am also all about this word. I am about this word of God. Jesus said, my words, they are spirit and they are life. so often. I told you the other day, I'm on a path, I'm on a journey with you guys, amen? The other day I had my grandkids in the car and we just stopped at the Quick Trip to get them some kind of a little treat, and I'm just backing out and leaving. And something about the way I backed out, I didn't hit nobody. But anyway, this guy, I hear cussing back, you know, I had the window part way down, I hear cussing behind me, and I'm thinking, well, who's he cussing? I look in the mirror, he's looking at me. I look in the side view mirror, and I'm not even going to tell you. I don't even know why he was mad. My first instinct, I'll just tell you plain, my first reaction, I wanted to back over the guy. Just put it, I got a nice big heavy car, you know. Would you all say that's flesh? Wasn't Nathan with the knife? My first reaction, I'll just back over that dude, you know, say nothing to him. My grandkids are in the car. I'm thinking that's not a good witness for them to see their grandpa splat this guy. But I really did begin to hear on the inside. You know what I began to, I know it was the Holy Spirit, but he was bringing me the words of Christ. He says, love your enemies. Forgive those that do evil to you. Pray for them. Before I reached that Quick Trip parking lot's not very big. Before I reached the street to pull out, I was already making intercession for that guy. Well, his word, and I know the Lord heard that. And the Lord did something. I may not find out till heaven, but the Lord used that prayer to do something for that guy. I don't believe in prayers that don't get heard. I don't believe in prayers that don't get answered. My God hears and answers prayers. Does yours? You know? But the Holy Spirit began bringing me the red letters. He began bringing me the words, see? And so let's look at it again in Matthew 28. I just want to hammer this home that when he says, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, I am appalled at the ignorance of born-again, spirit-filled, New Testament Christians. I am appalled at their ignorance of the word. I am appalled at what they don't know. Now, I'm not so much talking about this church. You guys are pretty well taught here, okay? But you go talking with people that's been Christians for 20 years and you think, my God, what are they teaching wherever you, if you go to church at all, what are they teaching? I heard one preacher one time says, you've not been teaching, you know, we're supposed to, it's okay to desire the sincere milk of the word. But he says, you haven't been even giving them milk. You're giving them water. Just pablum or something, you know. I want to see it again. This is the commandment of Jesus. Look at it again. Red letters, Matthew 28, verse 19. Go you therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. We could stop right there and have a whole seminar on the Jesus only thing. Come on. If you got a Bible, read. Enough said. Verse 20. Well, what am I supposed to teach them? Teaching them to observe. To do. I'm glad you brought that up. It doesn't mean just have knowledge of. Yes. Teaching them to observe. It's one thing to know you're supposed to pray for your enemies. It's another thing to pray for your enemies. Amen. It's one thing to know you're supposed to forgive no matter what they did to you. It is another thing to forgive, and I mean from the heart. And I've told you how he'll take you by the hand. Y'all heard my testimony many times. That couple did me wrong, and he says, I had to forgive them, and I searched my heart. There's nothing in me that wanted to forgive them. But he said, would you be willing to be made willing? Okay, I'm not willing right now. But I guess if you could make me willing, I guess I would be willing. So, okay, I'm willing to be made willing. How would you do that? And he just had, you know, you've heard that story. He just had me start praying, just that simple prayer that he would bless them. Now, the point being, he led me because I was willing, yielded. I wanted to go on. Really, there was nothing in me at that moment that wanted to forgive them, but I wanted to go on with him. And he plainly told me, you're not going to go very far with me unless you forgive them. Now I'm in a catch-22. I don't want to forgive them, but I want to go with Jesus. Well, he'll lead you. But teaching them to observe. And this is where the Holy Spirit, oh, thank God for the ministry of the Holy Spirit who brings us the mind of Christ. See, I would have, without being able to discern his voice, thank God for our pastor again, who taught us and, you know, laid it out so simply for years, how to discern and hear and understand that voice of the Holy Spirit. Really, the Holy Spirit, he's just bringing you the mind of Christ. It is your Lord. This is how he comes to you. Chapter 14, he says, I will come to you. I'm not going to leave you as an orphan. I will come to you. But he does it now by the agency of the Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost has not come to replace his lordship. The Holy Ghost has come to bring you his lordship. And those red letters are not going to change. And they're for us today. And I don't care what those guys say. If you don't forgive, you're in trouble. You need to let the Holy Ghost teach you to bring you the mind of Christ. And don't tell me you can't. You can. Be healed in Jesus' name. I broke this one time. I hit it too hard. Be healed. Then it got me back. It's still, anyway. You can. And that's why he gave us the Holy Ghost. And that's the whole message, or a big part of the message of Pastor Dave. Everybody has strongholds. You can tell me about your upbringing and the stuff that happened to you. I can tell you about my upbringing and the stuff that happened to me. And your stuff may be worse than my stuff. It depends on how you measure it. Do you know none of that matters? You are a new creature in Christ Jesus. Now, it doesn't mean your soul isn't wounded. It is. And it's got strongholds there that's bothering you. But the Holy Ghost is here to bring down every stronghold. And I don't care what it is. I don't care what it is. He'll bring it down. But he needs your active participation. And that was, here we go back with Nathan. I hear that thing with Nathan today. He says, now look, we're not against confession. We're supposed to walk the floor and say what the Bible says about us. I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. I am a new creature in Christ. Old things have passed away and all things have become new. Hey, I believe in that. I believe in confessing the word of God, but understand you're not moving God. You're not impressing God. He knew that before you started your confessions. You are changing you. You are ministering to your own soul. You are conforming. You're teaching your own soul the truth. See? But like Nathan said, it's one thing. Even when you really believe it, that's fine. But there's still a possessing of the land. To go around and say, I'm the righteousness of God in Christ, which you should. And then go home and scream and yell in anger at your wife. You got some land to possess yet. Amen? And that's going to require your humbling and your listening to the Holy Ghost. And he has an instruction. Yes, sir. I've been rereading again one of my third favorite book. This is my first favorite book, the Bible. My second favorite book is Pastor Dave Roberson's The Walk of the Spirit, The Walk of Power. My third favorite book is The Wigglesworth Standard. The Wigglesworth Standard. It's actually, if you search hard enough, you can find it now for free on the internet in PDF format, the whole book. I have it in the Kindle version from Amazon. It's like a few dollars. And for me, I love that. I have it everywhere I go. Got it on my phone, got it on my computer, got it on my iPad. I can reference it anytime. I've been reading again about Smith. Smith, I wish I'd have brought that one. Do you know Smith raised 14 people from the dead? Tens of thousands, it says, tens of thousands worldwide were saved through this man's ministry. Tens of thousands were healed through this man's ministry. You ought to read what he says about the Word of God. He had a love for the Word, and he had a love for the living Word, and he had a relationship with the living Word by way of the Holy Ghost. But he loved this Word of God. And I wish I would have brought some. Eventually I will. I want to bring some more statements by him about the Word of God. And it ought to just shut the mouths of any of these people that say, you don't need the written Word of God. Liar, liar, pants on fire. You need to feed on all of it, especially the New Testament. Get the New Testament in you. Do what Dave said. Assimilate it. 30 times at least. Get it in you 30 times. Then what's the next level? 50 times. Maybe after 100 times, you can start reading the Old Testament. you can read it. But if you don't have the revelation of Jesus and the new birth, you're a little bit in danger in the Old Testament because you don't understand, you'll wind up back under the law. We're not under the law. We're under grace. Amen? But there is a law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. And that's where Nathan, here we go again, back and forth in these messages, you know. And Alan just amplified the whole thing. But Nathan brought it back again. He says, well, that new nature, that's your guide, that's your teacher. Every situation you get into, use a green light, red light, do this, don't do that. You've got it already. But we need the words of Christ. Okay, we'll read it one more time, then we'll go back to John 15. What are we supposed to teach? Teaching them to observe, that means do, all things whatsoever, how inclusive is that? Whatsoever I have commanded you. He's not talking about the things he will say. How many of you know the Lord still speaks today? Hebrews says, that same letter to Hebrews, today if you will hear his voice. Today. How many of you know it's always today? But here he's talking about whatsoever I have commanded you. Do you know in John 14, 15, 16, at one place he says the Holy Spirit, one of his functions is to bring you to your remembrance everything the Lord has said. And I found that to be the case. You know, that's not going to happen if his word does not abide in you. His word needs to abide in you. Feed on it. Smith Wigglesworth would not have a meal without reading a chapter out of the Bible. And I mean, everybody be quiet, not just him read it. Whoever's at the table, even at a restaurant, now I'm not saying we need to have to be quite that bold yet, but we may get there. But he says, he said, the need for spiritual food is more important than the natural food we're about to eat. I need this spiritual food more. And he was talking about the literal word of God. So, teach whatsoever I have commanded you. These are the red letters. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Now go back to John 15. See, what we're really after is revival. Amen. Revival in Tulsa, revival in India, revival in San Francisco, revival everywhere. Real revival. Where the blind see, the lame walk, the deaf hear. And I mean all the time. All the time. Where the whole world can come. And again, I'll say, I've been in prisons enough already. I have tried to win over Muslims with a word debate. You know, they know their Quran. I know my Bible. We have 30 minutes debating with each other. At the end of it, I didn't change him. He didn't change me. We're both just mad. You know. But you take that same Muslim guy, if he's got a blind mama or a blind daughter, and you pray in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, and that daughter or that mama gets a miracle, he's going to want to hear about your Jesus then. See? He's going to want to hear. Jesus is really alive. Who did that? Jesus. He's alive? I told you. Yes, he's alive. Tell me more. See, that's how the world will know that the Father has sent him. See, and I got to go. Let's just go to it. That's right near the end of John 17. I hope you've been assimilating John 14, 15, 16, and 17, praying in the Holy Ghost. But he says that right near the end of it. Let's pick it up in verse 22. The glory which thou gavest me, I have given them. Thank God for Pastor Dave breaking that. I wish I could say I broke it. He broke it. What is that glory? It's sonship. The glory, that he started off saying, I'm going to my Father's house, and my Father's house is many mansions in the King James. Really, the word there is rooms, permanent dwelling places. In the house. See, the servant abides not in the Father's house permanently. But the Son has a room, a permanent dwelling place in the Father's house. He's going, right now there's only one that's being occupied, and it's mine. But I'm telling you, in my Father's house, there's room for you. And I am going to make a place for you so that you'll no longer just be a servant. You are going to have your own room as his child in the Father's house. You're a child. That's the glory that he has shared with us. We are sons and daughters. children of the Most High God. He says, the glory that you gave me, this glory of sonship, I have given it to them, that they all may be one, even as we are one. What do you mean by that, Jesus? He explains, I in them, and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one. And notice, and that the world may know. Boy, when that happens, he started this off in John 14. He says, believe me, just if nothing else, believe me for the very work's sake, because it is the Father in me. He's doing the works. Well, one of the reasons the world doesn't believe us, we're not showing them the works. He says, if I do not the works of my Father, believe me not. And we haven't, and they don't. They don't believe us. Jesus is alive. Show me. Will he heal my mama? If I can get Patrick to pray. Will he heal my blind child? See? Well, he's alive. Put up or shut up. That's where we are. And he said, if I do not the works, believe me not. Well, we haven't, and they haven't. But that's about to change. That's about to change, right? Say yes, there's people here. Yes, amen, amen, okay. So, I in them, and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that thou hast sent me and has loved them as thou hast loved me. Father, I will that they also, whom thou hast given me, be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory, which thou hast given me. For thou hast loved me before the foundations of the world. Now, we could go on and teach there, but we got a couple of minutes left. Go back to John 15. I want to emphasize this. Verse 5, he's really talking about staying saved. I am the vine, you are the branches, he that abideth in me. He's talking about the pressure that's going to come. Got to remember, all these guys that he was talking to right there are Jews. And they're going to go from the law to Christian. And are they going to suffer persecution? Oh, yeah. And all hell's going to break loose against them. Not only against them, but every Jew that they led to Christ. And that's the reason for the letter to Hebrews. Because the pressure's on, buddy. Man, I'm going through hell here. Why? Because I'm a Christian. How do I get the hell to stop? Reject Jesus and go back to the law. And the big warning is, and here it is, verse 6, if a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered. And men gather them and cast them into the fire and they're burned. I mean, you can't get more graphic than that. It's Christ or perish. The writer of Hebrews also says, talking about the Mosaic covenant, says he taketh away the first that he may establish the second. There is no Mosaic covenant to go back to. It's not okay to go and offer the blood of a living lamb and put it on the altar where Christ's blood is already there. That won't work. There's no Mosaic. He taketh away the first that he may establish the second. Okay, but verse 7, we'll finish here tonight. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, you shall ask what you will, and it shall, say with me, shall. See, it doesn't get any more, words don't get stronger than shall, and it shall be done unto you. Well, what's that predicated on? If my words abide in you. I am appalled at the Christians I meet who do not have his words. And I'm more appalled by these large Christian ministries. I mean, these people have churches with 20,000, 40,000 members. They're on TV in Tulsa. Just about every 30 minutes, you can turn on one of them if you want to. And it's heresy to the 10th power. It's heresy. It's leading a generation into destruction. It's prophesied by Peter and Jude, saying the day has come where they're going to come in bringing damnable heresies, even denying the Lord who bought them. Now, how are you going to come into church and say Jesus is not Lord? It's not talking about that. That's not what, if they said that, none of us would listen. No, that word denying means to say no to. And they're going to come in saying, I know you said that, Lord, but that was for the old covenant. We're saying, no, I don't have to forgive. We're saying no to your teaching because we've been taught that it doesn't apply to us. That's the very ones. That's the beginning. It's going to get worse. It's going to get worse. Because right now, the ones that I'm thinking of in my mind, they're not saying, just go sin. But they are removing all penalty for it. The next wave will be, you can do whatever you want. That I'm not really teaching on radical grace. What he's after now, tonight, if you abide, verse 7, if you abide in me. See, in this group, and the group that I know that's listening around the world, I don't really think most of you or them listening are in danger of turning away from Jesus. The danger I have found, even with people that have loved God for 20 years, the ignorance, and I don't mean it in a, how do I say it nicer? Is there a way to say it? They don't know what he said. His words are not in them. It's real easy. Just start asking a few questions. You'll find out. And his words are not in them. And he said, well, I'm not bearing fruit. Verse 7. If you abide in me and my words. Now, abide. Yes, sir. Last quote from Wigglesworth for tonight. He says, the word of God is dead until the Spirit breathes on it. Notice that word abide? That word there means live. If my words live in you. I like how Dirk said it. It's the doing. It come alive in you. It's not something you just have knowledge of. This is your life. This is what you act on. When his words come up, that's what you do. If my words abide in you, you shall ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. By that process, herein, that means by that process, is my Father glorified. How is he glorified? When you bear much fruit. So shall you be my disciples. Now we come full circle. He that believes on me, the works that I do, shall he do also. And greater than these shall he do, because I go to the Father. I'm going to say it one more time. It was never the Father's plan that the ministry of Jesus end at the cross. He says, I'm just a single seed. But if a seed fall into the ground and die, it beareth much fruit. No, it was the plan of God for the ministry of Jesus to be multiplied millions of times over in all of us believers around the world. That's only going to happen as we teach what he taught us, breathed on by the Holy Spirit to the point it's who we are. Amen? To be continued. Hallelujah. Okay, that's probably enough for tonight. Hallelujah. Just say it with me. Jesus, I abide in you. Your words abide in me. Your words are alive in me. By this process, herein, I bear much fruit, and the Father is glorified through the Son. In your name, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, glory, glory. Well, make sure his words abide in you. Okay, we're going to start the confessions now. If we have any extra copies, I'm sure that Vincent and Alina would probably like a copy they could look on. What we're going to do, I'm going to explain to them a little bit. This portion, that's why we call this, this portion that it takes about 20, 30 minutes now. Oh, okay, you already know. Okay, good deal. See, they're members already. I just haven't seen the faces, you know. Not many churches. There really isn't very many places I know of where you can go and get practice calling those things which be not as though they were. It does not come naturally to human beings. Human beings call things that are the way they are. But for the next 20, 30 minutes now, we're going to take all these statements and say them as though they were already established fact. Amen? So just repeat after me. Say, Father, I worship you. I glorify you. And I praise you. You're not a man that you could lie. You have exalted your word above your name. Heaven and earth will pass away, but your word will never pass away. Therefore, I say, your glory is present at the prayer center. The blind see, the deaf hear, the lame walk, the dead are raised, and the poor, they have the gospel preached to them. A minimum of 1,000 people are born again at the prayer center every week. We have a minimum of 500 intercessors who are holding up the message that has come to maturity. We are able to get along with each other while the Father works revival in our midst. We have that kind of worship that takes us beyond the veil of the flesh in order that we may worship in spirit and in truth. We worship you, Father, out of our new nature. We give you family worship as your sons and daughters. Father, at the prayer center, those that come will see a people transformed to the nature of Christ. Father, we say, in the name of Jesus, no person ever leaves the prayer center the same way they came. Every person that comes receives a touch from the Good Shepherd. Father, those that come who are beaten down, discouraged, worn out, and tired, they won't leave that way. They'll be encouraged, strong, and mature. They'll leave standing upright, their shoulders squared, their heads held high, going forth as a mighty army to take this planet for your kingdom. In the name of Jesus. Father, your glory fills every service. And every person that comes drinks of your glory. They'll leave as earthen vessels filled with your glory, filled with your wisdom, filled with your love, filled with your grace, and anointed by your Spirit. They'll carry your presence with them. They'll carry revival around this world. Oh, I need to do it tonight for me. I want to. Let's make it personal. Let's do it this way. Every time I come, I drink of your glory. When I leave, I am an earthen vessel filled with your glory. I am filled with your wisdom. I am filled with your love. I am filled with your grace. And I am anointed by your Spirit. I carry your presence with me. And I carry revival around this world. Father, we declare, we preach your gospel. We'll never settle for man's gospel. Only yours. It's the gospel that saves, the gospel that fills, and the gospel that heals. That's why we say, lost, be saved. Empty, be filled. Blind, see. Lame, walk. Deaf, hear. Maimed, be whole. Dead, rise again. In the name of Jesus. Father, that's your gospel. We'll settle for nothing less. We're going for the gold. We have what we say. And we say at every service, the lost are saved. People are filled with the Holy Ghost. The blind see. The lame walk. the deaf hear, the maimed are made whole, and even the dead are raised. In the name of Jesus. More than 12 legions of angels are loosed to prepare the way for revival. Angels are dispatched to the four corners of the earth, intercepting and stopping every mission and every assignment of the enemy that would bring circumstances against those who would come. Angels are changing those circumstances by rearranging them and causing money to come and by changing schedules. We say every person that is to be here will be here in the name of Jesus. There is no devil big enough, no assignment crafty enough, no circumstances bad enough that will keep even one from being here. Father, we declare your house full. Angels are moving back the forces of darkness over this region. They're opening up a window. A window of light, 25 miles in every direction, both horizontally and vertically. There is a fortress of angels surrounding us to keep back the darkness. Father, angels are dispatched now, softening the hearts where hurts have wounded, where calluses have formed, where walls of defenses have gone up. Angels are softening the hearts and creating atmospheres where the people can hear the voice of their shepherd. Angels are preparing their hearts now, so they're already receivers when they arrive. From the first word spoken, from the first song sung, from the first prayer prayed, to the end of every service, the people are free to receive from your Spirit. The assignments of all devils against the prayer center, the people of the prayer center, and the leadership of the prayer center, all those assignments are dismissed. In the name of Jesus, I declare those plans null and void. Devil, we're taking Tulsa from you. In fact, we already have. Jesus is Lord over Tulsa. Not you. We're in authority here. Not you. Devil, get out of Tulsa. Take all your demons with you. The King of Kings has made a decree. And I am speaking in his stead. The King has declared, this is the acceptable year of the Lord. The King has decreed, captives, you are free. Every person returns to his original inheritance. That is the born again trail. Father, you have restored our inheritance. And at the prayer center, the inheritance is not just known about. We don't just teach about it, but it's received, manifested, and seen. Father, you have restored our fellowship with you. The firstborn told us to pray, Father, your will be done on earth just as it is in heaven. As in heaven, so on earth. As in heaven, so in Tulsa. There are no lost people in heaven. Therefore, we say, Tulsa is saved. There's no sick people in heaven. Therefore, we say, Tulsa is healed. There's no demoniacs in heaven. Therefore, we say, Tulsa is delivered. There's no poor people in heaven. Therefore, we say, Tulsa is prospered. And Tulsa is blessed. We declare every captive free. Every wheelchair emptied. All of them, no exceptions. Every artificial help, wheelchairs, crutches, canes, hearing aids, glasses, stretchers, bladder bottles. They may need them when they come. They won't need them when they leave. And we'll have them here as trophies. To the glory of Jesus the healer. All manner of sickness and all manner of diseases are healed first time, every time, all of them, no exceptions. Jesus, you healed them all then. You healed them all now. That's what we say. That's what we have. In the name of Jesus. Father, there are impartations of your Spirit. We declare these are the most powerful, the most anointed, the most life-changing, the most revival-producing services in history. Fresh anointings, fresh giftings, like never before, since the book of Acts. Father, it's you doing the works. Therefore, all things are possible. Now let's talk to our soul like David did. Say, soul, my own soul, I command you. Believe this. All things are possible. All things are possible. All things are possible. Every backslider will come back to God. They will never leave God again. So now, Father, in preparation, I forgive every person their trespasses against me. Let's do that one again. We get kind of out of sync. So now, Father, in preparation, I forgive every person their trespasses against me. Father, forgive me all of my trespasses against you. I am freshly washed in the blood of the Lamb in order that my record in heaven be perfect. Therefore, I say, because of the blood, what Jesus did for me, according to my record in heaven, I have never failed God. I lay down my life that the life of Christ may be manifest in me. I take no offense. I give no offense. And according to my record in heaven, I never have. At the prayer center, the mind of Christ is delivered to the sheep and the shepherds. It's delivered with such simplicity and with such clarity that the wayfaring fool could not misunderstand it. Therefore, I say, the people at the prayer center, and especially me, we all understand every word that Pastor Dave teaches. And we declare that Pastor Dave teaches. Every need is met. No matter how large, no matter how small, there are no cases too hard. There are no cases too late. Whatever they come for to receive from Jesus, they get it. All of them. First time. Every time.
Every time.
No exceptions. No exceptions. I declare every captive free.
I declare every captive free.
Free in spirit.
Free in spirit.
Free in soul.
Free in
soul.
Free in body.
All are delivered.
All are restored.
All are restored. Father, you are provider.
Father, you are provider.
Angels are dispatched. To gather in all of the finances and everything that is required. Things we know about now. Things we don't even know about yet. Because you are the God who answers before we call. I speak against the strongholds of lack. And I declare an abundance. Abundance. Be in the name of Jesus. Therefore we say, there is no lack. We operate from abundance. We operate from surplus. We have all in abound with many baskets left over. We have such abundance. We can pay the way for many to come and many to go. And we send them out on prosperous journeys for God with abundance in a manner fitting for servants of the Lord. Our financial granaries are full because our King has found stewards he can trust. And I'm one of them. Father, if you need anything,
come to my house
first. Don't go to Daisy's house first. Come to my house first. All I need to know is my Lord has need of it. And it's yours. I've been bought with a price. My life is not my own. I am a first-class servant. Lord, I lay all my possessions at your feet. I say again, Lord, if you need anything I have, it's yours. I love you, Lord, with all of my heart, all of my soul, all of my mind, and all of my strength. The second commandment is like unto the first. I love my neighbor as myself. Now remember, you're not lying. You're calling things that be not as though they were. So say, I love my good neighbors.
I love my
bad neighbors. I love my mean neighbors. And I love my enemies. Jesus, you're my Savior.
You're my
Lord.
Whatever you ask,
that's what I do. I am your servant.
I am your
bond slave. By my own free will choice. I serve you, Lord, by serving these people that you love so much.
I serve the good people.
I serve the bad people.
I serve the mean
people. I especially serve your enemies.
I especially serve your enemies.
I lay down my life for your
enemies.
Because you're trying to save them all.
And
you'd like to use me to do it.
All that I have
is yours.
My time is
yours.
My body is
yours.
My family is
yours.
I own nothing.
I am your
bond slave.
Use me as you
will.
You are
a provider for me.
My family and all that I have.
And
I am available for your
use.
We lift up the blood-stained banner over this city.
Written in the blood of Jesus on the
banner are these words.
Jesus is Lord over
Tulsa.
Jesus
is Lord over
Tulsa.
Tulsa
is in revival.
Tulsa is in
revival.
And where
Jesus is Lord,
the
Father's will is
done.
So,
Father, have your way.
Not just 30-fold.
Not just
60-fold.
But
100-fold.
Again, I say.
Lost.
Be saved.
Empty.
Be filled.
Captives.
Go free.
Blind.
See.
Deaf.
Hear.
Lame.
Walk.
Maimed.
Be
whole.
Dead.
Rise again.
In the name of Jesus.
Father, thine is the kingdom.
Thine is the power.
Thine is the glory.
Forever.
Your will be done in Tulsa.
Just as it is in heaven.
As in heaven.
So in earth.
As in heaven.
So in Tulsa.
Tulsa is saved.
Tulsa is saved.
Tulsa is saved.
Now shout about it.
Hallelujah!
Glory, glory, glory!
We have what we say.
Tulsa is in revival.
Hallelujah!
We have what we say, Lord,
and we thank you for it in Jesus' name.
Hallelujah!
Hallelujah!
Glory to God!
Hallelujah!
We have what we say in the name of Jesus.
That is the truth and nothing else is.
Glory to God.
Hallelujah.
Glory.
Praise God.
All right. Well, just, you don't have to repeat after me, but just extend your faith and maybe your hand towards this prayer box. First of all, Father, you know that every face, every picture here represents an impossible case according to what the world has to offer. Even modern medical science has no hope at all for these. But Father, you are the God of all hope, and all things are possible with you. Father, we know that you heard us the first time. That's why we're not going to pray again tonight for these. Father, we've already prayed. We're going to treat you like you're real, like you heard us the first time. And Father, we believe we received when we prayed. Therefore, there's only one conclusion. We shall have it. In Jesus' name, we shall have it. Every one of these miracles, Father. And Father, the prayer request inside this box. Father, there's probably everything here from the simple things to difficult things. Everything from hangnails to suicide and everything in between. Father, your word tells us that if we ask anything that's according to your will, we know that you hear us, Father. And that's all we need to know, because our confidence is if you hear us, then we have the petition that we desire of you. So, Father, we're just joining our faith together with these in a prayer of agreement, really. Father, we're thanking you for answering every single prayer that Jesus paid the price for them to have. And, Father, even a stranger, if a stranger sent in a prayer request here, Father, and if it's according to your will, we don't care if they're agnostic, atheist, Hindu, Buddhist, or anything else. Father, if they had enough faith to send a prayer request here, we're asking like Solomon asked. Father, answer the prayer of the stranger. Father, do it in such an unusual and unique way that they'll have to know it was you that answered that prayer. So they can know, like we already know, that you're the only true and living God. And they can hear the gospel of your Son and be saved in Jesus' name. Father, every prayer cloth that goes forward from this place has that same tangible anointing of the Holy Ghost. You have not changed at all, Father. You're the same God today that you were in the book of Acts. And Father, we declare every cloth that goes forth from here, when they're laid on the sick, they will recover. When those claws are laid on those that have devils, those devils will come out. Father, that means that insane people will be instantly set in their right mind. Bipolar people will be instantly healed. Schizophrenic people will be instantly healed. Alcoholics will be instantly delivered. Drug addicts will be instantly delivered. Marriages will be put back together. Wayward children will just come to their senses, return to their parents, and you'll turn the hearts of the parents to the children. And Father, many, many more things you do, because you're much bigger than our thoughts or our prayers, and you have not changed at all. You're the same God today that you were in the book of Acts. Father, we lift up Pastor Dave and Rosalie, Father. Father, we just thank you that Rosalie walks in the full manifestation of healing. Father, she's restored to full health, able to do everything as a wife and a mother and a grandmother that she should be able to do. And we just thank you, Father, for your divine healing presence. Father, we thank you for their house, for their children and their grandchildren. We lift up Tim and Leah Stemple and their house to you, Lord. Father, all Red Polston and his wife, Father, all of the ministers, not and their families, not only here but around the world, that have connected, Lord, with this vision. Father, and the staff, and those that aren't even officially on staff, but in your sight they are. And Father, all the members too, we declare no weapon formed against them will prosper. But everything they set their hand to do will prosper in the name of Jesus. And Father, we've discovered the tactic of the enemy. We've discovered his number one tool, and that's to send the persecutions, afflictions, the cares of this world, the lust of other things, and the deceitfulness of riches, to send those things continually to steal our time. We found out, Lord, what it is. It's to steal our time. Even if it's good things, Lord, but it steals our time. Lord, we're faced with another week. We're going to gather here again next Sunday night, and we will have used those hours for something. We have the same number of hours available to us as the President of the United States or anybody on earth. Father, help us steward our time. We know there's things we have to do. We know there's things that you have made us accountable for. But Father, we're also accountable for the vision you've set in front of us. Someday we're going to stand in front of you and give account of the stewardship of the life you gave us. Father, help us steward our time so that we allot the right amount of time for prayer, for fasting, for time with you, for worship. All of the things, Lord. Father, we want to be able to say, like the Apostle Paul said, we fought the good fight, we kept the faith, and we finished the race that you set in front of us. Father, for us, that race is revival. You told us plain. That race is revival. And Father, we declare, you will have your revival. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody says, amen, amen, amen.